place. Shut up and stay out the way. Shut up. Decided what I'm gonna do today. What? I'ma ghost ride the rave. Ghost. I'ma ghost ride the rave. I wanna look at the stars today. Ghost. I'ma ghost ride the rave. Ghost. I'ma ghost ride the rave.
How's it going, guys? Once upon a time, there was a world where music video budgets were massively big and their production mirrored the quality and the complexity of feature films. Then budgets and production quality suddenly dropped. My name is Josh Olufemii and I'm in Brisbane, Australia for the next couple weeks. And in this video, I want to ask the question, what happened to the music video industry? And now in the second decade of the millennium, are music videos finally marching back to their former glory? It's been well known to my audience the directors that have influenced me the most. Matt Alonso has been my biggest creative and business mentor for the last 3 years. Clarence Peters' work has shown me the professional way of using lighting in building all-encompassing worlds in your sets. Assistant editing with, say, Mike Ho taught me the importance of using pancake timelines when organizing your footage within Premiere. I remember having to learn After Effects in 2 days when doing music video editing years back for director Andrew Sandler, and I discovered the huge world of creating expressions and creating masks to create incredible music video effects. And then I remember just looking at Colin Tilley's work, which taught me how to create video concepts that had massive scopes. Looking at Meji Alabi's work has always told me the significance of always creating spatial depth and intricacy in all set design. But all these great creatives that I just mentioned got their start in music video production during the internet age, the first part of it anyway. We remember this time in the late 90s and the early 2000s when the music industry was put into a massive shock because of the sudden availability of free music. Online file sharing websites like Napster and LimeWire completely stripped the music industry of their physical record sales, and it threw music video budgets far south of their former seven-figure glory of, say, the early 90s. It's incredible hearing from legends like John Landis, David Fincher, David Myers, or Hype Williams talk about the golden age of music video production, when cash-heavy record labels would readily drop $1 million plus on music videos. These music videos were incredible cinematic masterpieces with massive, specially built sets, multiple days of production, and they would often use the cutting edge of camera and post-production technology. Music video directors were essentially feature film directors in training, with many of them after the fact graduating into the world of feature films. I mean, guys, we're talking about an age when people had to physically purchase albums in order to hear their favorite music. Album sales were such a huge revenue source for labels that even the money that they got from tours didn't even compare. I mean, today tour revenue is absolutely coveted by artists and record labels alike. Back then, music videos and tours were rather thought more of as advertising agents to help drive more physical album sales. YouTube's global head of music, Larry Cohen, described this time as a time when the music business was a audio visual business, where we prioritized the commercial performance of the audio over that of the visual. While music videos alone weren't thought of as a massive revenue source, I mean, remember, even MTV didn't really ever pay to play music videos were still proven to be a highly effective agent in driving sales for physical albums. So we get it, music videos were once massively incredible cinematic masterpieces, and then the internet hit and everything seemed to go haywire. But things are about to get better. It's time to zoom along to 2003, where we introduced the creation of one of the internet's most influential music platforms, the iTunes Store. Unlike LimeWire and Napster, the iTunes Store was safe, meaning that you knew you could download music and get the actual song that you wanted and not some dangerous internet virus. The user interface was easy to use, and the most important thing was, it wasn't free. iTunes was a platform that made it easy to legally download and store music, and it gave record labels and artists their first major revenue-generating tool for their now digital music content in the internet age. It was nowhere near the revenue that they were able to get from physical album sales. I mean, people can now buy digital singles instead of having to buy whole digital albums, but it was better than nothing. But then things started getting better for the music industry, and LimeWire was completely crushed by this massive 2010 RIAA infringement lawsuit, and it made LimeWire have to completely close its doors. Napster suffered similar legal issues like years before, and they had to close their doors, and they actually turned into a legit music video platform, kind of like iTunes. But then you had these streaming platforms that started coming to the scene. First you had Pandora, then you had SoundCloud, then you had Spotify, and then you went to Apple Music, and they took money back out of the game again, lowering profit margins to record labels and artists when compared to online digital album sales. And then, to make matters worse, it happened. Film equipment got affordable. The first full HD video DSLR came out in 2008, dropping the minimum price of a professional video capable camera from tens of thousands of dollars to just a couple thousand dollars with the Canon 5D Mark II. GoPro started creating light, portable, and eventually waterproof action cameras. The Chinese giant DJI Technology Co. created a formidable competitor to full-scale production helicopters with their drone technology. I mean, let's talk stabilizers. When the DJI Ronin M first came out for about $1,500, it was competing directly against the Movi electronic stabilizer that at the time was costing, I think, like $10,000 or more. And then that Movi was supposed to be a cheap version of, say, the $100,000 Steadicam weighted non-electric stabilizer systems. And then video editing in 2013, the Adobe Creative Cloud came out, basically allowing you to rent your video editing software without having to pay thousands of dollars to buy it outright. And all this together just caused the market to be flooded by this massive new wave of creators that could now finally afford to create. A high school student could go now and film his or her own music video without a team, using their own equipment and editing it all by themselves. Production companies would often hear this dreaded misguided commentary that usually involved their proposed budgets being shot down because, say, the label CEO's son had a friend that offered to shoot that same treatment at a fraction of the cost, all by himself. So taking all this into account, is this basically me saying that there's no hope for the professional music video production world? Are music video budgets basically doomed forever? Not everyone's gonna agree with me about this, but I personally say no, and here's why. This is because the music business is now changing from an audio-visual business to a visual-audio business, where the actual music video is now becoming the new profitable asset. It's no longer the audio recording. With the rise of online video hosting websites like YouTube, music videos have actually become pretty profitable view magnets, which basically means that they attract a captive audience. This is basically allowing advertisers to partner with music video financing through, say, the use of in-video product placements and pre, mid, and post roll ads. And check this out, the demand for videos are growing fast. For example, I actually just read an article by venture capitalist Andrew Chen, who stated that videos are now the new technology of scale. He actually made the incredible example that it took the 2012 YouTube video for Psy's Gangnam Style 5 years to get to 3 billion views. But it only took the 2017 Latin crossover music video Despacito 1 year to accomplish the same feat. These bigger and bigger viewing audiences just translates into bigger revenue for record labels and artists alike. Lastly, spreading a video release across these new multiple new video-based media platforms like lyric videos, static photo videos, which basically just has the music playing beneath a static picture, and vertical videos further increases viewership and therefore ad revenue. And then there's actually one more thing. When I was doing research for this video, I actually hit my bro and mentor Matt Alonzo up, and he had this really good point. It's not only that the demand for videos have grown, the demand for quality videos have skyrocketed in recent years. And I think he's actually right, because if you think about it, I believe people are getting to that point where they're just getting sick of amateur content. I mean, check out the rise of popularity of long-form cinematic content on Vimeo, and check out the generally recognized rejection now of cheap VFX and transition template packs. Cheap and amateur-looking music videos these days generally are not gonna be remembered longer than a 15-minute fad, and definitely for the most part will not get you an MTV award. I mean, guys, let's compare Soulja Boy's Fast Car with cinematic masterpieces like Tiwa Savage's 4999, or Tekno's Panna. I mean, another comparison could be Left Cheek, Right Cheek's video Dip with Koffee's new incredible video W, which we're gonna tackle in a little bit. This demand for higher quality videos is actually commanding bigger budgets. Because as talented and as creative as a high school student could get with this new technology, there's still a standard of production quality that just cannot be reached without a standard production budget and a professional production team. Affordable $1,000 Sony video DSLRs may be a thing nowadays, but there's still a clear visual difference between that and, say, a $100,000 Arri Alexa setup with its 4.5K resolution, Arri RAW codec, push to dynamic range in the highlights, beautiful color science, and awesome bit depth. As incredible as that high school student's parents' garage is as a music video shoot location, it doesn't even hold a candle to a professional film shoot location like The Reserve in downtown Los Angeles. The Reserve is actually an old bank vault turned bar that can be rented for up to $10,000 for the day. And you can't forget the additional hefty $2,500 permit fee that the city of Los Angeles will always charge when you film in that section of downtown. On top of equipment and crew costs, Matt Alonzo also brought up the good point that high concept production ideas simply just take longer to dream up. And all that time costs money. I know from personal experience that it sometimes takes me 2 whole days of pre-production to actually come up with a complex treatment and shot list. And again, this high demand for high concept video ideas that may closer mirror those that you would need to come up for a feature film further forces labels to drive up those music video production budgets. All right, guys, we've covered a lot of stuff. As far as the future goes, just to sum it up, I feel like that music videos are here to stay, at least for a while. It's just plain and simple. Video content has become king. The establishment of easy and affordable video hosting on the internet in the last decade has allowed video to become the most preferred medium of marketing and promotion in almost every industry. So I think this trend will continue and just push further demand for quality music videos in the future. So guys, we're gonna rewind back to Koffee's new music video W, directed by Matt Barron. When I first watched this video play out, the first thing I thought of was, I'm watching a film. It's one of several examples of how well-funded, beautiful cinematic visuals have been working their way back into the music video world. The video starts with a cryptic word of encouragement, and then comes an intriguing piece of narrative foreshadowing when he says,
Lord, open the heavens and shower down the blessing on your people. Shower down the blessing.
So the basic story is an approaching storm embeds fear in a community, but the twist is that with that storm comes this cloud of wealth. Like literally. A twister begins to rain all these dollar bills onto this town, evidently soaking it up from some source somewhere else. And basically the harsh storm ends up being a blessing in disguise and everyone gives thanks to God. It was actually a pretty cool narrative. They actually released the video around Thanksgiving, so it all plugged in well. The first thing that you're gonna notice is the entire video is shot in this wide anamorphic format. This immediately broadens the visual scope of the piece. And then the video used environmental audio popping. That's basically when you hear elements of the environment popping over the sound of the music. Whether it be the sound of thunder or the rumbling of the ATVs, these audio elements helped sustain the viewer's suspension of disbelief that the video's narrative structure was actually happening. Something else, if you watch the video for a little bit, you might notice a specific color theme. Blue, orange, and red. And you gotta remember, blue is on the direct opposite side of the color wheel against orange and red. Sticking to that consistent color palette just helps to give the video its neat and intentional feel. The use of contrasting colors as well as contrasting light intensities induces perceived spatial depth, which help pull the viewer further into the footage. I think the use of silhouetted lighting also helps maintain the dark tone of the video's environment as the dark clouds of the storm approaches and eventually hits the town. Notice that while not all the talent is actually silhouetted, most people will have a larger portion of their face that's going to be in a shadow and a smaller portion of their face that's actually going to be lit. I love the two breaks in the song that happened to actually transition to different parts of the narrative. The second break actually happens right at the narrative's twist when it's revealed that with the storm comes this monetary surprise.
As the winds are picking up and the storm is just making landfall, everybody sit tight as this is something we may not have seen before.
I actually love how the video is edited, as Richie Ramirez taught us in a past tutorial. Most songs are in something called 4-4 time, which basically means you're counting 1, 2, 3, 4, and then after every 4 beats you start over.
It's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Most people, including video editors, always hear the downbeats of music, which happen at every 1 and 3, and they usually cut to those downbeats.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
This can really make your edits actually begin to feel predictable and sometimes boring. The interesting thing is, I realized that this video actually allowed a lot of shots to linger like they would in a feature film. The editor didn't necessarily seem to be as worried about cutting to every downbeat of the music, but kind of cut after a narrative element had finished playing out, or when, say, a camera movement had been completed to the fullest. I thought this was interesting. There's no completely right and wrong way to edit, but this was a cool little change. Another thing I liked the combination of action and reaction shots in the B-roll. It's important not to only capture the captivating action of the storm coming in, but also the reaction of the local townsfolk looking up in dread. A few other things I liked how a lot of the dramatic audio cues of the song were matched with dramatic visual cues, like the money cloud exploding into the sky during fast musical ramp-ups. News in the Another random thing I liked, I like how consistent the fog thickness was across touching shots. You may not realize this, but keeping fog levels consistent between takes can actually be a huge hassle, and when done wrong can cause some really weird looking jump cuts. And lastly, I thought the sky VFX was amazing and highly realistic. I love when they composited the fake lightning in the scene that they remembered to include the ambient light splash on the fog in front of Koffee's body. It really sealed the realism of the lightning elements. Quality VFX composite work usually requires a reliable source to get quality individual compositable elements such as storm clouds, lightning effects, and fog overlays and the like. Envato Elements is a subscription service that literally gives you unlimited downloads of over 500,000 overlays, stock footage, VFX packs, title packs, transition packs, and a ton of other dope digital products for only $33 a month. And by clicking on my link below, you'll get an automatic discount of only $9 for the first month. And guess what? You can literally cancel at any time without any charge. And guys, every subscription that we get really helps the channel, so please check it out. This is something that I use almost every day. I download so much random stuff. Check out this aerial footage that I used in this clothing ad that I recently shot in New Zealand because I didn't have a drone on site. Envato Elements has been a terrific channel sponsor. I promise you will not be disappointed. So guys, next time you watch a really dope music video, I hope you just sit back and you appreciate the incredible journey that the music video industry has been on. And I actually hope of there being an even brighter future. You know, let's hope so for all of our sakes. Guys, please like this video. Please click subscribe and click the notification bell so you'll be notified for future videos. Thanks so much for watching. And as always, guys, remember to keep it chill.